I'm deeply grateful to the CHAZAQ organization and to Rabbi Oppenheimer and the Young Israel for inviting me to come to speak at this very important time of the year. Those of you who don't know, CHAZAQ is one of the greatest Kiruv Torah learning organizations that exists in this country. They have so many programs and so many people come throughout the day, throughout the night. It is just incredible. Yaniv, Hashem should bench you together with your brother, Rav Shlomo. And Rabbi Oppenheimer, I thank you for allowing me to speak at this podium. And of course, I just want to put in a plug for one of the great organizations in Klal Yisrael, which is TorahAnytime.com. Literally, wherever I travel in the world, whether it's Australia, whether it's Mexico, Switzerland, people are always telling me that they watch TorahAnytime.com. They have literally thousands and thousands of shiurim, men, women, mashgichim, rosh yeshivas, everyone. For any type of Torah that you want to learn, it's available on Torah Anytime. I had a wonderful, wonderful friend in London. His name was Sammy Hamburger. Everybody in Golders Green knew him and loved him. He was Rabbi Dr. Emanuel Jacobowitz's son-in-law. Unfortunately, he passed away at a very young age. He passed away, he was only 40. He left a wife and many, many children. But throughout his life, once I got to know him, we became almost like brothers. He was such an open, gregarious person, always learning with everyone and just the most wonderful person. He was the president of the Menorah School, which is a primary school in London. And he was very jovial, and he would love to tell over this story. Now, of course, he would tell it over in an Irish accent because it happened with an Irish painter, but I'm not even gonna try. But just imagine this give and take with an Irish painter and Sammy Hamburger. Sammy Hamburger was repainting his home, and he had this Irish painter come, and Sammy knew that there's a din in Shulchan Aruch that not many, many people are noyeg, and the Mishnah Berurah says we understand that not many people are noyeg, but still it is a law in Shulchan Aruch in Simen Tov Kuf Samach, in Hilchas Tisha B'Av, and it says like this, Mishachorav Beis HaMikdash, from the time that the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed, Tiknu Chachomim, the Chachomim decided that Jews forever should not build big, ostentatious homes like palaces, but rather they should keep their homes simple. And in every home, opposite the doorway, there would be an amma by amma, that's like 2 feet by 2 feet, or 1.5 feet by 1.5 feet, which would not be painted, which would be left alone, so that it would be a zeichel l'churban, a memory to the Churban Beis HaMikdash. The Mishnah Berurah writes that there are some people that make a black box, and in there they write the word Zeichel HaChorban, and that's acceptable as well. But Sammy decided he's just going to tell this painter, just paint all around it, just measure out an amma by amma right opposite the doorway so that when people come in, they'll be able to see it, and that's what we want to do. Now, this painter never heard of anything like that. And he says to Sammy, well, why in the world would you want to make this wall not look perfect? You know, I can paint the whole thing for you at the same price. And Sammy said, well, unfortunately, we had a temple that was destroyed. And so we want to commemorate the loss of that temple. So the Irish painter says, oh, I'm sorry. I must have missed that on the news. When did that happen? So Sammy said, oh, about 2,000 years ago. Well, this guy almost fainted. 2,000 years ago? He said, why don't you let bygones be bygones? I mean, it's 2,000 years. Can you imagine a Goyish person thinking that way? I mean, so Sammy tried to explain it to him that by us, there's no such thing as bygones. And it's very interesting. Rav Shach once made a great statement, and he said, a Jew who is not tied to the past has no hope of being connected to the future. The second world looks at the future. That's where it's all about. But by a yid, it's not that way. We look to the past to prepare ourselves for the future. We look at the gedolim of the past. We look to be inspired by those people who came before us to be able to prepare ourselves for the future. And therefore, there's no such thing as bygones, especially when it comes to the Churban Beis HaMikdash. As a matter of fact, what's frightening and what really makes us get together and think about it is the Yerushalmi and Yuma that tells us, Kol dor she'eina nivne biyamov, any generation that the Beis HaMikdash has not been built, ke'ilu hu hechrivan. It's as if, chas v'shalom, the people of that generation destroyed it. So this is a very, very critical expression. The Yerushalmi is telling us that if in 2013 the Beis HaMikdash was not built, that's because almost we destroyed it or we don't deserve it. So how could you let bygones be bygones? Just the opposite. We want the Beis HaMikdash more than anything else. We want Mashiach to come. So we have to be connected to the past. And we have to think what went wrong, what is going wrong, and how can we change it. So let's begin right from the beginning of the month of Av. And I remember when I first became a speaker, so my father, Olav Shalom, he had been very close to Rav Shimon Schwab. Rav Schwab, before he came to Washington Heights, was a Rebbe in Ne'er Yisrael. He was a Rav in Baltimore, and he was a Rebbe in Ne'er Yisrael, and my father was one of his Talmidim. So when Rav Schwab came to New York, my father would call him every once in a while. And when my father passed away, years later, when I became a speaker and I needed some information on a topic, I would call Rav Schwab. He would pick up the phone and he would talk to me for 10 or 15 minutes. He said, okay, I think you have enough. And he would hang up. And I remember one time I had to speak on the topic of Simcha. And he told me a remarkable insight in a Gemara which we all know. But listen to how Rav Schwab was medayik in the Gemara. The Gemara Tainis Chavtes Amar Aleph tells us the famous thing, Mishenichnas Adar Marbim B'Simcha. Everybody knows that. When Adar comes, it's the happiest month, we all increase our Simcha. And then Rav Schwab said, the same daf tells us, Keshem Shemenichnas Av Mematin B'Simcha. When Av, the month of Av comes, you minimize your Simcha. But Rav Schwab said, doesn't say you don't have Simcha. It says you minimize your Simcha, but a Yid always has to have Simcha. Very interesting. Even in the month of Av, which is the saddest of all months, because we speak about and we say Kinnis and Eicha about both Bat and Mikdash that were destroyed, is no such thing as a Yid is totally without Simcha. Mematin b'Simcha. We minimize our Simcha. So the question, of course, is, what is there to be happy about in the month of Av? It really is the saddest month. And the B'nai Yisoscha deals with this, and he says, isn't it interesting? Many of us know the Gemara. The Gemara also is in Titus Chav Amud Beis, and it tells us, on the 15th day of Av, Lo Yehoyu Yomim Toivim Li Yisrael, there was no greater Yontef in Klal Yisrael like the 15th day of Av. Why? Shebehen Benois Yerushalayim Yotzeis B'Klei Lavan, girls would go out, and that's where they found Shidduchim. Could you imagine if we had a day every year where all the girls could get Shidduchim? That would be the biggest Yontef of all. I mean, people would be dancing in the streets. And that's what happened on Tu B'Av. Here, Tes B'Av is the saddest day, and yet on Tu B'Av, Chazal are teaching us there was never a Yontef that was as great as Tu B'Av, because that's when people were able to get Shidduchim. So there is a touch of happiness in the month of Av, because in the time of Chazal, that was a day of Shidduchim. However, there's something else also. Do you know, this Monday night, which is going to be Tisha B'Av, just a few months ago, Monday night was the first night of the Seder. It was the first Seder night. And every single year without fail, the first night of Pesach, whether it's Tuesday night, Wednesday night, whenever it is the exact night that we lain Eicha and Tisha B'Av. And we lament the loss of the Beis HaMikdash. Isn't that incredible? What is the connection between the first night of Pesach and Tisha B'Av? And it's interesting, some people have the minig to eat an egg in salt water before they actually start the meal. And that's one of the reasons that we eat it at the Pesach Seder, because we know that that year, whether it's Monday night or Tuesday night, is going to be the night of Tisha B'Av. So we make a Zecha L'Churban even at the Seder. But to me, it's a different thing altogether. And to me, one of the most moving piyutim that we have in the Kinnis is the one that begins Eish tukat bikirbi, a fire of elation rises within me. Bahalois alibi, when I think about how great it was b'tseisi mimitzrayim, when we went out of Mitzrayim, and the men surely know that there is a certain nigun that most shuls sing it all over the world, and it is so haunting and it is so beautiful. And then comes Nebuch, the next line. Kinim or ira. Kinim means lamentations and sadness are awakened. Laman askira, when I remember Betzesi mi Yerushalayim, when I went out of Yerushalayim. So in the kinis, we're comparing the night we went out of Mitzrayim with great joy and the sadness of when we went out of Yerushalayim with great sadness. And so there is a connection between the both of them. And what's the element of simcha? The element of simcha is that last phrase. The last phrase in that kinos tells us, sosoin v'simcha, one day there will be joy and happiness. V'nos yogoin v'anocha, and worry and sighing will go away, b'shuvi l'Yerushalayim, when we come back to Yerushalayim. And so even on the night that we cry, when we say Eicha and Kinnis, we know that that night was a night of Chayrus, a night of freedom, and one day that's going to be restored, and once again Tisha B'Av will be a Moyed. And so therefore, when we lay in the Kinnis, we have to remember, it's not only total sadness, but that same night that we are crying about Eicha, if we can only figure out what we can do to enhance Klal Yisrael, to make ourselves better, then that same night can be, as the first night of Pesach, a night of Chayrus. So I want to share with you something very touching, and that will lead into something that I believe that each and every one of us can improve in, especially in the month of Av, and how appropriate it is in the month of Av, as you will see in a moment. Many years ago, there was a little 10-year-old boy that lived in Gateshead, which is in the northern part of England. And one day in autumn, he was walking with his Rebbe, with his Malamed, and they were walking in a park, and the leaves were gorgeous, red and brown and green and orange. And as they were walking, a few leaves were on a park bench. And the Rebbe said to the little boy, "You see these leaves here on the park bench? These leaves, they think they're free. They think they can fly wherever they want. But they don't realize that in 2-3 days, they're going to wither and die because they're no longer connected to the source. It's only when they're still connected to the tree that they could blossom and flourish. They just think they're free, but it's only a matter of time until they die." And he says that's what Torah is, and that's what Jews are all about. Eitz chayim hi l'machzikim bo. The Torah is a tree of life to those who hold on to it. Those who go away from the Torah, they think they're free. And then the Malamed said to the little boy, "My child, I want you to know that as you get older, you're going to meet all kinds of people. And they're going to say, 'We're free. We can look where we want. We can drive when we want. We can eat what we want. We're free.' And they don't realize that that's the beginning of spiritual death. It's only when somebody's connected to Torah and its laws, that's when he can flourish, and that's when his family can grow properly. But otherwise, it's the beginning of spiritual death." And that little boy told me that that message carries him till this very day. And that little boy is Rav Matasyo Solomon, the Mashgiach of Lakewood. Now today, unfortunately, he's not well. And when I saw him 2-3 years ago, I asked him, "Do you remember who that Malamed was?" He says, "I no longer remember, but I remember the message. And it carries me till this day." And that's the commitment we have to make. It's not only mitzvahs, as we will see in a second, but it's limud ha-Torah and hachzokas ha-Torah. You know, in the early 1900s, there was a great rov that was here in New York, and lately people are writing about him and going to his kever, and his name is Rabbeinu Yaakov Yosef. Some of you may know that he's buried along the interborough of the Jackie Robinson Highway, and many thousands now go every year on his yahrzeit. And over the last number of years, I've taken people, you know, people think you got to go to Poland, you got to go to Lithuania. There are quite a few people here who went with me on those trips. But you would not believe what's doing along the Jackie Robinson. I'm telling you, it's amazing. Rav Yaakov Kamenetsky is buried there. Rav Palm is buried there in his Rebbetzin. The Chovetz Chaim's second wife, Rav Ruven Gazovsky, Rav Shlomo Hyman, many in the Soloveitchik family, Rav Henoch Leibowitz, Rav David Leibowitz. It's unbelievable what's going on, literally 15 minutes from where we are tonight. It's amazing. But Rabbeinu Yaakov Yosef, when he came to be what was called the Rav HaKolel, the Rav of many, many different shuls, and unfortunately, he was given a very hard time. And one of the people who came to America and came to give him chizuk was a man who was known as the Ritvaz, Rabbi Yaakov David Wilofsky. His primary reason for coming to America was to raise money for a sefer he was writing, which is classic. It's a perish on the Yerushalmi. It's called the Ritvaz on Yerushalmi. And of course, he was a great tzaddik. And he came to the Lower East Side, the Pike Street Shul. Now, unfortunately, today, if you pass in the Lower East Side, the Pike Street Shul is a Chinese bastion, or I don't know, it's one of these Asian shuls, or whatever you want to call it. But in those days, of course, the Pike Street Shul was the most prominent shul in Manhattan. And many people came to hear him. And listen to what Rabbi Yaakov David Wilofsky said in the early 1900s. He said as follows. He said, many years ago, there were communities that were called mitzvah yidden. That meant they were not Talmid HaChomim. They certainly respected Talmid HaChomim. But what they did was they had such a love for mitzvahs. And in that way, they were able to give it over to their children and grandchildren. For example, some communities excelled in Shmir Shabbos. They were so careful about Shabbos. Others were so careful about Kashrus. Others were so careful about Tefillah, never missed a minyan, always had minyanim. And this love that they had for these mitzvahs, they were able to give it over as mitzvah yidden, they gave it over to the next generation. But as soon as the winds of secularism came, and the winds of immorality, and the winds of materialism, then they couldn't pass it on to their children anymore, because those winds were too strong. So Rabbi Yaakov David said the only way they could do it was through Limud HaTorah, by learning Torah, building kolels, building yeshivas, building Beis Yaakovs. And then he said a fabulous pasuk that we all know, and listen to how he interpreted it. He said the pasuk tells us, Ki ner mitzvah v'torah or. A mitzvah is strong, but it's only a candle. If we would light a candle right now in this Beis Medrash, and there's no windows open, there's no wind blowing, the candle could go until it just peters out at the end. There's no oil or there's no wax left. But as soon as the wind comes, that candle's going to be blown out. But what if you would have a torch, a fire, and a wind comes? We just saw what happened in Arizona. We see every year what happens in California. When there's acres and acres on fire and the wind makes it stronger, the wind makes the fire go even further. And that's what he said. A person, a community has to know that as great as mitzvahs are, it's only ner. It's only a candle. And it could be put out by the winds of secularism and materialism. But when a community is steeped in learning Torah and having siddurim and having programs of Torah, when the secular winds come, just the opposite. It gives the person strength and the wherewithal to become stronger with that or, and therefore then they'll be able to combat all those winds. Because the Torah and the or is much stronger than the winds. And if that's the case, now we can understand something brilliant that the Ben Ish Chai writes. The Ben Ish Chai writes, why is this month called Av? And he has numerous reasons. And one of the reasons is amazing. All of you can take a look at Masechet Shabbos, Daf Kuf Dalet Amud Aleph. It's a fascinating Gemara to learn with children and grandchildren at the Shabbos table. You know why? Because it tells us about the Jewish alphabet. Why is the Aleph shaped the way it is? Why is the Beis? Why does the Gimel have a leg that's running towards the Dalet and the Dalet has, like, part of its leg is going back? And the Gemara explains it all. And the Gemara says, you know what Aleph Beis really stands for? Aleph Bina. Aleph means to go learn. Bina is understanding. So the Ben Ish Chai says, you know what the month of Av is all about? Aleph Bina, learning Torah. And he writes how sad it is that in the world, most of the world, the summer months are in Av. And that's when people go on vacation. I just had the opportunity to speak in Landis College Friday morning. I was so moved You can't believe how many guys, they're on vacation. They're coming to sit and learn. Nobody's forcing them. They're Beis Medrash Bokrim, high school boys. They were little boys. I couldn't get over before Bar Mitzvah that come to learn. You mentioned Rabbi Brandberger as one of the people. He's the Mashgiach. He was there as well. It's incredible. And that's really what make the Ben Ish Chai so proud, because in the month of Av, when people are on vacation, he says, Aleph Bina, make sure that you learn. And you know something? He brings, of course, the very sad Gemara. The Gemara tells us that what is one of the reasons why the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed. The Gemara tells us in Adorim, Omar, Rabbi Yehuda, Omar Rav, She'ein Mevorchin, Batayra Tchila. They didn't say Birchas HaTayra. What does that mean? And the Ron explains, when people treat Torah learning as a subject, there's math, there's science, there's English literature, and then there's Torah. You don't make a bracha before you learn math. Nobody's going to make a bracha before they read English literature, even if it is a Maggid book. Nobody's making a bracha about it, right? But the idea is, if you treat Torah as a topic, so when you make the bracha, it's not choshev. That's what the Ron says. It's not that they didn't say brichas atzayra. It's not that they didn't learn, but they weren't enthralled with it. They didn't think this is the ingredient of life. So says Rabbeinu Yaina, Vada yoskim b'Torah tamid. Of course they were involved in Torah. But it wasn't important, it was just like a topic. I'll learn for 20 minutes, fine, because I have to learn. But they weren't enthralled with it. They weren't excited about it. So therefore, maybe the first thing tonight that each and every one must undertake in our lives, that in this month of Av, we're going to learn a little bit more than we've been learning in the past. We learn maybe one more Mishnah. We learn maybe one more Din Shulchan Aruch, and for women, it's the halachas that are negeya to them, whether it's in a Musa Sefer, or whether it's any Hilcha Shabbos, anything that's negeya to women. But Aleph Bino, that's what the month of Av is all about. And you know what Rav Segel used to say? Don't undertake big things. Oh, I'm going to say the whole Tillim every day. I'm going to learn Shas in the month of Av. It's never going to happen. You know what he used to say? Emor Ma'at, say you're going to do a little bit, and then I say Harbe, then you'll do a lot. And just last week, I saw something so incredible. I can't believe all these years, how many times have we heard about Rabbi Akiva? What made him start learning? Because he saw the rock that had the hole in it, and it was dripping and dripping and dripping, and then finally it pierced the rock, it pierced that stone, and he felt, wow, if the constant flow of that dripping could pierce a rock, so Torah could pierce my head. So this Sefer, which I just saw, which came out in Eretz Yisrael by a Rav Valach, says an amazing thing. How many drops do you think were there? Count them up. 10 gallons over the years? 20 gallons? 100 gallons? Let's say 500 gallons of water. Imagine if you took 500 gallons of water and you poured it on a rock. Nothing would happen. It would just flow right off. The idea was it was one drop at a time. One small drop. Constant dripping. That's what made the hole. And that's what we have to do. Not that we're all going to take a big thing, no. Every day, we never said Tillim before, we're going to say one Perek. And it grows. We never learned Tanakh. How many people here learn Tanakh? Don't raise your hands. Okay? When are we going to, at what age do we start learning Tanakh? I'm not telling you to learn Yirmiyah and Yecheskel and Yeshaya. But what about Yeshua and Shoiftim and Shmuel and Malachim? Rabbeinu D'Alma, it's a story. It's not that difficult. Every person should know Tanakh. Every Gadol knows Tanakh. Maybe we should begin learning Tillim or Kehelas or Mishlei. At what age are we going to start learning these things? Don't learn the whole Mishlei and Av. No, one pasuk a day, two psukim a day. Small things. That's what the month of Av, Aleph Bina. Shalei Bercha Batayra Tchila, that was one of the causes that Hashem was angry. I'm giving you for the ingredients of life, and you disregard it. You treat it like math. You do me a favor, you learn 20 minutes a day. What is that? It has to be with an excitement. That's why they make a Brichas HaTorah, to show that you really are thrilled with it. We're all familiar with the story of Kamtza Bar Kamtza. But to me, there's one line in that Gemara that to me is so penetrating. And I believe B'derech Drush we can learn a great, great lesson. Let's just go over the story very quickly. Kamtza was a friend of the host. And by mistake, somebody invited Bar Kamtza. Bar Kamtza comes, and the host says, get out. He says, please don't embarrass me. Get out, I don't want to see you here. please, I'll pay for the whole meal. Get out. And he's very embarrassed. And the Rabbanim that are there, nobody stands up to protect this guy from being embarrassed. And he gets very angry. So what does he do? He goes to the Goyish king. And he says, you know something? The Jews hate you. He says, come on. They appreciate me. No, 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 he says. You watch. You bring a sacrifice, right? The sacrifice, the Goyim allowed to bring a sacrifice to the Beis HaMikdash. You bring a sacrifice, and you'll see they won't accept it. He said, it's impossible. He says, okay, give me an animal. King gets him a beautiful animal. He says, okay, take it. I would like to see if they're not going to accept it. And look what happens. On the way, this yid, what does he do? He makes a mum. He puts in a flaw, an imperfection. But listen to what the Gemara says. Shod bei muma. He put in a flaw. Beniv svasayim, in the lips, or some say in the eye. And here's my expression. Duchta a place. Dilididon have a muma. By us, that's a flaw. If there's something wrong with your mouth or something wrong with your eye, by us, that's a flaw. Lididon, but by the Goyim, that's not a flaw. In other words, of course, the Gemara is talking about the halacha, that what is a mum by a Goy when he brings a carbon, a broken leg, a broken head, a broken foot, a hand, whatever. But if it's got a little split in the lip or a little split in the eye, that's nothing. That's not considered a flaw by Goyim. But I think there's a deep lesson here. A Goy doesn't care what he says. We have to care what we say with our mouth. By us, that's a flaw. If you say something off color, or if you cause machlokes, or if you get angry, by us, that's a flaw. The Rabbi Hashem doesn't expect that from Goyim, he expects it from us. If we look in a place where we're not supposed to look, if we look at someone and become jealous, by us, that's a flaw. And maybe that's a second tikkun that we have to begin worrying about. Our eyes. Let me tell you an adorable story. You know, Rav Elia Lapyan was a tremendous, tremendous tzaddik. And he had a yeshiva in Kfar Hasidim in the northern part of Eretz Yisrael. If you see the pictures of him, because most of the pictures are when he was older already, he's blind in one eye. There's a very famous, adorable picture. I don't know if you've ever seen it. He's holding a little pan of milk for a cat outside the yeshiva. You got to get a hold of that picture. It's beautiful. Anyhow, one day, a boy from a very modern family who was in the yeshiva says to Rabbi Elia Lapyan, Rebbe, I would like to take off a day or two. My family, they're making a chasana. So Rabbi Elia Lapyan knew that this boy is from a very modern family, and he was afraid that there might be mixed dancing there. So he said to the boy, Es wird sein Taruvois, there'll be mixed dancing. So the boy said, yeah, but it won't affect me. So Rabbi Elia Lapyan said, I'm an old man. I'm blind in one eye. And when I go to a wedding and women are dressed the way they are, it affects me. If it doesn't affect you, please give me the name of your mother so I can daven for you. Imagine that. He said the kid was sick. Of course, we have to admit that sometimes there's things that are exciting to look at, but they're improper to look at. And perhaps that's one of the tikkunim that we have to make in the month of Av. The eyes are something that's a flaw. By us, the lididon have a muma. By us, it's a flaw. Maybe not necessarily by the goyim. So they can look at any advertisements. They can look at any media. It doesn't affect them. And if it does affect them, Hashem is not demanding such high standards from them. But from us, he demands these high standards. And we have to be a little bit more careful. What does it mean about nivel peh? You know, it's a very uncomfortable thing to talk about. I can't imagine that women are as nichshel and nivel peh as men are. Men are in the workforce. They deal with people from the secular world. And sometimes a person gets angry and he lets out a curse word. Or sometimes a person is angry at an employee and lets out a curse word. Or sometimes you want to show that you're in, so you'll tell a joke that's not appropriate. It's off color. But I just want to tell you what to me is one of the most frightening gemaras. Take a look at it in Ksubas Daf Ches Amud Beis. Kol hamenavel espiv. Anybody who tells a joke that's off color or says something that's inappropriate or immoral, or moitzi dova nevola mepiv, and he brings out something that's a dova nivol, that's inappropriate from his mouth, afilu nechtam like zardinoi shel shivim shana latoiva. Even if he was destined in Shemayim to have 70 years of good, nepach alov l'ra, chas v'shalom, it can turn. Being a person that says these type of jokes or uses those types of words is frightening. It's frightening what Chazal are telling us. We're supposed to be on a higher Ramah. The way we speak, l'didon have a mumah. By us, that's a mum. That's a flaw. By goyim, it's not. They'll tell all those kind of jokes. And again, you come into the workplace, everybody's laughing at those type of jokes. You want to be on the in crowd. It's a big nesayin. I presume most women don't have the nesayin that men have in these things. But we as men have to take it seriously, what Chazal are teaching us. I want to tell you something about machlokes. I have a brother-in-law who today lives in Lakewood. And I remember many, many years ago, he opened a camp with someone, a summer day camp. And for whatever reason, then they decided to take a third person in. And so the three of them were partners. And you know how businesses go. Three doesn't work all the time. So after a while, those two decided they're going to run the business, and they got rid of my brother-in-law. He was devastated. It was his idea. The whole thing was his idea. But, you know, he's a gutinker. You know, he's a guy that people can roll over sometimes. Very honest fellow. And he suffered terribly from it. And he didn't know what to do. Should he go after them? Should he make a whole argument? After all, he was the one who started it. And at that time, Rav Shalom Shradron, the Maggid of Yerushalayim, was in America. And so he went to Rav Shalom and he told him the whole story. And he said, listen, I can make a big machlokes here because really, I was the one who started the business and now they're getting rid of me. It was incredible what Rav Shalom did. He took out his wallet. And he said, I want to show you what I carry in my wallet. And he took out a very frayed index card. And on that index card was part of a letter which is called Igeres HaMusar. A letter of Musar Lerebi Avram Benoy Shel Rambam, from Avram, the son of the Rambam. Now, I'm only going to read one or two lines in Hebrew, and then I'll translate the whole phrase and the whole sentences in English. Al tishatzu es nafshoisechem b'machloikis ha-mechala ha-guf v'ha-nefesh v'ha-momoin u'manishar oid. This is the English translation of the sentences. Do not defile your souls with arguments that destroy the body and the soul and your finances and what else is left. I have seen light complexioned people become dark. I have seen families become afflicted. Princes removed from their prominence. Large cities desolated. Groups split asunder. Respectable people embarrassed and humiliated because of arguments. Rav Shalom said, walk away. Very difficult to do. But the result of machlokes eats away at families. How many families do we know where sisters are not talking to each other for years? They don't even know anymore why they're not talking to each other. They just know it's a mesira. They're passing it on to their children, and the children have the same prejudice. A person should be big enough, and it's not easy, to walk away from machlokes. And you know how you walk away from machlokes? The first time somebody says something to you, don't answer back. Because you answer back, then they answer back, and it goes back and forth and back and forth, and families are ripped asunder, shuls are ripped asunder, communities are ripped asunder, and Klal Yisrael's ripped asunder. This guy likes this Rebbe? Fine. So he has this Rebbe. This Rebbe does something that your Rebbe doesn't like? So fine. Don't use him as a Rebbe. This Rav Paskin, something that you don't like because your Rav Paskin's different, all you have to do is have one Rav that you Paskin like. You don't have to have the whole world Paskining exactly like you. There's no reason to talk Lashon Hara, to cause a machlokes, and to berate people, because that rips asunder Klal Yisrael. And then people and families hate each other, they take each other's sides. We all know Hasidic sects where there's two different Rebbes, and they won't marry into each other. It's awful. What kind of lesson is that to the children and grandchildren when people do that? There's no excuse for it whatsoever. That's what Chazal are telling us. That's what the son of the Rambam is telling us. Big people, when they're involved in machlokes, they fall from their prominence. They lose their money. They lose their reputation. It's terrible. So part of that flaw of the mouth is causing arguments. It's kas, getting angry, using nivul peh. As a matter of fact, it's so interesting. Most people won't even believe this. The first time my Rebbe Rav David Cohen showed me this, I was speechless. And for me to be speechless is a big accomplishment. Could you imagine, you know, if I were to ask you, which mitzvahs in the Torah have no reason whatsoever? Everybody's going to say Por Aduma. What else would you say? Shatnas, right? Everybody would say Shatnas. Listen to this Medrash Tanchuma. Look it up tonight. Bereshis Oizches. Vayovay Kayin Mipri Adoma. Kayin brought from the fruit of the earth, which was linen. Zera Pishton. The Hevel, he brought from the sheep, which was wool. Imagine that. Kayin brought linen. Hevel brought wool. Lefichach. That's why Nesar Tzemer Apishtim. That's why we can't wear shatnas. You know why? Because Hashem says, Ein Adin, it doesn't make sense. She Yisarev Minchas Achoite and Minchas Zakai. Doesn't make sense that I should look at something that brought death into the world, a combination of wool and linen, which caused the conflict because of jealousy. Cain was jealous of Hevel, and the first death happened. Why? Because somebody brought from wool, somebody brought from linen, and therefore there was an argument. That's why we don't wear shatnas. Could you believe that? Amazing. So my Rebbe, Rav David, said an amazing thing. There's only one person who can wear shatnas. You know who he is? Who can, everybody know, I mean, Yaakov, you surely know. The Kohen Gadol, right? The Avnate. The Avnate is made out of wool and linen. Why? Because the Kohen Gadol was Roidev Shalom, Oyev Shalom V'Roidev Shalom. He undid that machlokes of Kayin and Hevel. Incredible. That's what that Rizal says. So because of jealousy and because of machlokes, that's why we don't wear shatnas. But only the Kohen Gadol, who's Oyev Shalom V'Roidev Shalom, he can wear an Avnate because that undoes the machlokes of Kayin and Hevel. That's why Hashem doesn't want to see shatnas. That's why Hashem doesn't want to see machlokes. That's why in the month of Av, we have to make sure not to get into arguments. We have to make sure not to cause fights in a family, fights in a business, fights in a shul, and fights in a community. It's a fascinating Malbim. The Malbim tells us in the beginning of Parshas Truma, Va'asuli Mikdash, Hashem says to Klai Yisrael, make for me a Mikdash, v'shachanti b'soicham. And I will dwell in them. It should have said, I will dwell in it. Make for me a Mikdash, a holy sanctuary, and I'll dwell in it. That's not what it says. It says, I will dwell in them. Who's them? So some of Farshim say, it's both Bate Mikdash. You know what the Malbim says? I'll dwell in the people. And he says like this, Shekol Echad, every one of us, Yivlel Noi Mikdash, should build a Beis HaMikdash in his own heart. We, every single person here, is a walking, talking Beis HaMikdash. And I'm going to show you how. The Malbim shows us. Your head is the Aron Kodesh. What did the Aron carry? The Aron carried the Torah, which is the ultimate wisdom, as we said before, Aleph Bina. So your head that has the brains is the Aron Kodesh. Your heart, a person can't exist without a heart. A person can't exist without bread. Your heart is the lechem upon him. That's the bread, the showbread as it's called, that was brought from week to week. So here you have the Aron Kodesh, here you have the lechem upon him, and your stomach is the mizbeach. Just like the mizbeach consumed the food, the karbonis, your belly, your stomach also consumes food. So all of a sudden, wait a second. We're not just plain human beings. We're a walking, talking Beis HaMikdash. Here's the Aron, here's the Lechem upon him, and here's the Mizbeach. If this is the Mizbeach, I want to tell you something, but I don't want anybody to think about anybody else's family, because it's not right. Think about your own family and how you have to protect it. I remember Rav Segel used to say something from Rav Mendel Rimanover, who was the Talmud of the Rebbe Rav Elimelech. The Rebbe Rav Elimelech had many Talmidim. One of them was Rav Mendel Rimanover, and you know what he once said? He said, how come it is, and we find this today so much more than ever, you have kids that they're so wonderful until they're 12 or 13 years old. They're darlings, right? Boys, girls. And then what happens? They go off the derech. They give their parents Gehenim on this world. Their kids at risk. They went off to them. What happened? They were nice, sweet kids. And you know what Rabbi Mendel Rimanova says? And again, this is not for every family, and we have no right to think about this for any other family. It was just a way of protecting ourselves. He said it's because they're eating non-kosher food. Now, he doesn't mean, oh, you, okay, I'm okay, you're okay, he's not talking, triangle, okay, we're not talking about that. Rabbi Mendel Rimanova says that if a parent earns money dishonestly and buys food, that food is spiritually treif. That food, when it goes into the bloodstream of children, causes children to go off the derech. We're not talking about kashrus, standards of kashrus, badats and not badats. We're talking about money that was earned dishonestly. This food, whether it's the cornflakes or the cocoa pebbles or the bagels or the steak or the chocolate mousse, whatever you're buying, with that money that you really shouldn't have earned, it's not coming to you. That, chas v'shalom, is spiritually treif, and that has a terrible, terrible effect. And if that's the case, when we're worried about the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash, we have to worry about the destruction of our own Beis HaMikdash. Not chas v'shalom to eat anything from money that was not earned properly, and the same thing, not to give our children over in any such way. I want to tell you something fascinating. Maybe some of you know this, but every one of you, take a look as you read Eicha, you'll see something amazing. And you will be amazed if you never heard of this before. When Yirmiyah wrote Eicha, the first four parakim out of five, he made the psukim in Eicha according to the Aleph Beis. The first pasuk is Aleph Eicha, the second is Bochai Sivke, it goes on, Golsa Yehuda, Aleph Beis Gimel goes through the whole thing. That works only in Perek Aleph. In Perek Beis, Gimel, and Dalet. All the psukim are in a row except two of them. The same two in Perek Beis, Perek Gimel, Perek Dalet. Watch for it. You'll see. I have it underlined in my own Eicha because it's amazing. You know which psukim are mixed up, so to speak? Ayin and Pei. Now, normally we know the Aleph Beis, Samach, Ayin, Pei. But in Eicha, in Perek Beis, Perek Gimel, Perek Dalet, it goes Samach, Pei, Ayin. Why is it mixed up? Why is it in the wrong order? And the Gemara asks the question. And the Gemara tells us, the Gemara says, Bishvil ma higdim Pei la'ayin. Why is the Pei before the Ayin? After all, in the Yiddish alphabet, Ayin goes before the Pei. And the Gemara gives a fabulous reason. What does peh mean? Your mouth. What does ayin mean? Your eye. Bishvil hamaraglim, the spies, she'omru b'fiem. They spoke with their mouths, mashalei ro'u. They didn't really see that Eretz Yisrael was that bad. They went in with a preconceived notion. They didn't want to go into Eretz Yisrael because they knew there would be new leaders and they would lose their jobs. So they shut off their mouths before they really looked into it. They used their peh before they used their ayin. And in my humble opinion, that's why we have two eyes and one mouth. You should look into something twice before you speak once. And that's a great lesson for us to learn as we're reading Eicha. Don't use your mouth before you look into something. I got to tell you a great story. I was once at a dinner. And after I finish speaking, I'm walking to the elevator and a woman is running over to me and I'm waiting. Whoa, what does she want? She says, Rabbi Krohn, you know the principal that I'm talking about. I said, what are you talking about? He's your friend and he called my son garbage. I said, come on. He's a wonderful person. All of you know who he is, but I'm not going to say his name because you all know who he is. And I said, it's impossible. He's the nicest mechanic. He's the most wonderful person. I'm telling you, he called my son garbage. And she follows me into the elevator. I couldn't get rid of her until I got into my car. Now, I didn't know what to do, to tell you the truth. The next day I was driving and I was thinking, this lady doesn't know me. She saw me literally less than a minute. And she's already telling me how awful this mechanach is. So she probably told the whole world. So maybe I should call that mechanach and tell him, listen, you know, look, it's not my business, but I feel bad. You know that I like you. I respect you like anything. Maybe you want to call this woman and, try to straighten it out. Because if she's telling me, she probably told everybody. I couldn't make up my mind. Would I hurt his feelings? Would I not hurt his feelings? But I felt I had to look into it. I called him up. I remember I was driving on the Belt Parkway, and I begged him apology. I said, you know, I think you're the greatest, and you're so wonderful. But this lady, you know, I don't believe her. I want you to know I don't believe her. But just maybe you want to call her. And he's laughing. I said, what are you laughing at? He says, you won't believe what happened. She has a son in my school who's in the 8th grade. She thinks he's a genius. The kid needs help. It's not that he's a genius, just the opposite. He's far from a genius. She wants to put him into a very, very high class high school. I said to her, please don't do it. He's gonna be refused. And she thought he said, he's refuse. Could you imagine? She's going around telling the whole world, he said, my son is refuse, which is garbage. I said, he'll be refused. Don't do it for the sake of your son. So I don't know if he called her or not. But the point is, if I didn't look into it, if I didn't call him, who knows? Maybe in the back of my mind, I would have thought, you know, the principal's a nice guy, but listen, we all have our weak moments. But I looked into it before I said anything to anybody else. And why would I dare say anything anyway? But even saying to myself, a person has to use his ayin before he uses his peh. And that's what the meraglim, that's what their fault was. Here's another thing. This is amazing. I was just in England, and I heard this story again. I heard it a couple years ago. It's amazing. There was a boy who was learning in Gateshead, the yeshiva, for 3 years. And now he decided he's going to go to Eretz Yisrael. So they made him a Sudas Preda. Sudas Preda means like a goodbye party, because everybody loved him. He's a very popular kid. And everybody knew that his speech, because he was hysterical, this kid, his speech would really be something very special. Nobody would realize how special it really was. And he gets up at this Sudas Preda. First the Rosh Yeshiva, Rabbi Avram Gurwitz spoke, and then the Mashgiach spoke, and then this boy got up to speak. And he said like this. He said, we all know that our Rosh Yeshiva here in Gateshead, Rabbi Avram Gurwitz, is a great tzaddik. Everybody knows he's a big Talmud Chacham. But very few people know what kind of wonderful Bar Midos he is. And I want to tell you a story that even he, the Rosh Yeshiva, doesn't even know who was involved in this story. But it's about him. Oh, everybody wanted to hear what's happening. He said, I want to tell you what happened. I came to Gateshead 3 years ago. I didn't know anybody. 2 kids I knew in the school. After 2 days, me and those 2 kids, we got into an argument. And they started chasing me. It was lunchtime. I figured I'd run into the Beis Medrash, because nobody's in the Beis Medrash lunchtime. Well, I walked in, and there's a lot of guys in the Beis Medrash. So where was I going to run? So I ran to the back. There's a library, no windows. I ran into the library, slammed the door shut, and locked it. And these guys are banging, let us in. I said, what, are you crazy? You're going to beat me up. Get out of here. No, we need a safer. Get out of here. You don't need no safer. You just want to beat me up. So the guy says, I figured I'll be there a few minutes, and then they'll go away, and I'll go out. He says, I was there for about 2-3 minutes, and there's a knock on the door. I say, who is it? And a voice says, it's the Rosh Yeshiva. And I said, the Rosh Yeshiva, my foot. You're not the Rosh Yeshiva. Get out of here. You just want to beat me up. He says, I need a safer. Yeah, you need a safer. Yeah, Moritz. You guys don't know. You're just trying to imitate the Rosh Yeshiva. You're not the Rosh Yeshiva. He said, I waited there a few more minutes. There's another knock on the door. I say, who is it? He said, it's the Rosh Yeshiva. Yeah, the Rosh Yeshiva. Come on, guys. You know, how much are you going to play this shtick? You know, it's enough already. Come on, I want to go out. I want to eat lunch. I need a safer. Come on, you don't need no safer. You can't even read a safer. Okay. The third time when the knock came on the door, he said, I began to think, oh my heavens, it really could be the Rosh Yeshiva. He said, I didn't know what to do. I opened the door very slowly, and I see the Rosh Yeshiva standing like this, and he walks into the library, so I should be able to run out. He never saw my face. I never saw his face. Rosh Yeshiva, I want to tell you, Shalom Aleichem, it was me. And he said, I want to thank you, because if you would have seen my face that day, I would have left. The next morning, I never would have had the 3 wonderful years that I had here in Gateshead. Why did this kid shoot his mouth off? Because he didn't look into it. He didn't think, maybe it could be the Rosh Yeshiva. He's using his peh before he used his ayin. And boy, is he lucky that he had such a lovely, sensitive Rosh Yeshiva. Otherwise, he would have been out of the yeshiva, would have been tossed out even before he even got there. But that's again when somebody uses their mouth before they use their ayin. It's a very interesting Gemara. about Peh, about the letter Peh. Now, there are two Pehs. Again, this is in the Gemara in Shabbos Kuf Dalet, which I told you should learn because it's so fascinating about the Jewish alphabet. And by the way, I want to tell you one of the greatest books that Art Scroll ever published, besides the Maggid books, of course, is a book called The Wisdom of the Hebrew Alphabet. You must get that book. It's written by Rabbi Yechiel Arya Monk. It is so classic. Every single page you will learn something about the Holy Jewish alphabet, about the Aleph, the Beis, the Tes. Every letter, every page is precious. So, of course, he brings this Gemara, which I'm going to tell you right now, in Shabbos Kuf Dalet. There are two types of Peis. There's the small Pei, which is considered a Pei Sosum, a closed one. And then there's what my mother used to call the Lange Pei, the long Pei, right? Or the end of Pei, as some people say it, however they say it. Okay? So the Gemara says there's two Peis. There's Pei Sosum, Pei Pasuach. A Pei that's open, a Pei that's open, like the long one, or the small one, the one that's closed. And the Gemara says, you know why? Because sometimes you got to keep your mouth open, and sometimes you got to keep your mouth shut. And that's the right thing to do. We have a long Pei that's open, Pei Pasuach. Sometimes you have to stand up and say something. But sometimes the wisest thing is to be quiet. And I want to tell you a great story. Again, this happened in England at Tomchei Shabbos. All of us here know about Tomchei Shabbos, one of the greatest organizations in Klal Yisrael. So in Tomchei Shabbos in England, they have a very interesting way of working. No one can deliver a package in an area where they live. You can only deliver packages in areas where you don't know who you're giving to. You drop it off at the front step or at the apartment building on in front of the door and you leave. Nobody should be embarrassed. So they told me that they went to get money from a certain fellow who everybody knew had money. And they come into him, they said, listen, we're the two fellows who represent Tomchei Shabbos. We'd like to get some money for you. So he says, okay, I'll be giving you, but just tell me one family. Just one family who gets Tomchei Shabbos. I don't like to give to organizations because then I don't really know who's getting it. Just tell me one family. I'll feel connected to them and I'll give you. I said, what are you, crazy? We don't tell anybody. Tomchei Shabbos is private. No one knows. Only the two of us in the office. Nobody knows. Even when they deliver, they can't deliver to the neighborhoods that they live in. He says, look, I'll double my donation. Just one family. One family, tell me. They said, listen, obviously you don't get it. We're going to leave. You know, obviously you don't get it. This is a private organization. And they get up to leave. And he says, sit down, please. And he says, put me on your list. He says, I lost all my money. I don't have anything anymore. I can't even put bread on the table. But I was afraid that if I would call you, that somebody in the office would find out and everybody would say, wow, look who's on the Tomchei Shabbos list. But now that I see that you guys are quiet, and even for double or triple donation, you won't say anything, please put me on your list. That's greatness. A person has to be able to hold a secret. Every rav, every doctor, anybody in a position of power knows there's a level of confidentiality that's expected from them. But there's really a level of confidentiality for all of us. If somebody tells you something, sometimes in Yiddish there's an expression, somebody wants to talk, he feels bad, or she feels bad, she's got to talk it out to someone. Doesn't mean that you should broadcast it. The second you get off the phone with her, you're going to go call somebody else. The Pasuk tells us that Hashem called Moshe Rabbeinu and he told him, Lamor, go say it. And Chazal teaches us in Masechet Yuma that you're not supposed to say something that you heard unless a person says, this you have permission to go tell somebody else. By us, it's just the opposite. Unless somebody says, don't say anything, so all the matter we say. It's just the opposite, the Gemara says. Unless they tell you that you could say, then you could say. Otherwise, stop when somebody tells you something. Keep it quiet. It's private. I want to tell you one or two more things. We'll review and end with a fabulous story. Most of you know, and my dear friend Yaakov was with me when we went, where'd we go? To Poland together, right? I'm not supposed to tell anybody he made us see him there. He's such a big tzaddik. Made us see him, gave a speech. He's a good speaker. In case I can't make it one time, call him. But anyway, so we went to Poland, and there are other people here who have gone with me on other trips. And if you want to come this summer to Greece, it's fabulous. Unbelievable. We were there last year. It's one of the most beautiful places in the world. Very, very inspirational. Many wonderful Yidden lived in Greece. As a matter of fact, the one who wrote Lachodaydi, Rav Shlomo Alkavitz, he lived in Greece. Eventually, he moved to Tzfas with the Beis Yosef, but there's a lot of great Jewish history there. But one year, they asked me, please, take a whole group of people to Italy. I was thinking, Italy? Well, what's doing in Italy? But then I realized, the Masil Shishorim, he was born in Padua, which is right next to Venice. The Bar Tanura was born in Italy. That's where you get the wine from, the Bar Tanura, right? Doesn't it come from Italy? And the Sforna, of course, that's a town in Italy, the great commentator on the Chumash. And would you believe the Or HaChaim HaKodesh? I used to think the Or HaChaim HaKodesh was a chassid. He was a Sephardi Jew. And he went through Italy. And if you take a look, you wouldn't believe it. You take a look tonight at the Hakdama of the Or HaChaim HaKodesh. He wrote it while he was in Livorno. All the people. You think he's writing about the mafia. Every guy ends with an I or an O or an E. It's unbelievable. Calzoni, Ciccomeni, whatever. All these Italian guys. And they were all great Jews. You can't believe the Or HaChaim was, he loved them. He loved those Jews. They were wonderful Jews. But you just can't believe the names. And so he loved Italy and the Chidah. Most people don't know this. They wanted the Chidah to be the Rav of Yerushalayim, and he refused, and he moved to Italy. He married a girl from Pisa. Or Pisa, not Pisa. Pisa. But that's who his second wife was. So the great Tzaddikim lived there. But I knew that the last day of the trip, that was going to be the most moving. Because the last day of the trip, I was going to take them to the Roman ruins. Now, Rome is different than any city in the world. In any city, whether it's London, Los Angeles, New York, every place, they're always trying to show you how modern they are. In Rome, it's just the opposite. They're trying to show you how ancient they are. So you have buildings with stairs that lead no place. You have pillars that are only half there, but that's the ruins, that's the Heilige ruins of Rome. But there's one thing that bothered me so, that it is in its perfection, a state of perfection, as if it was built yesterday. And that's the Arch of Titus. Titus is the one who destroyed the second Beis Hamikdash. Titus was one of the main Roman generals that took Yidden out of Yerushalayim. But say you see him in Yerushalayim, that's Titus. And not only that, so many Jews were killed in Yerushalayim. Other Jews died along the way going to Rome. And others died as they were building the Colosseum. Many of them were sold for slaves. It was a terrible, terrible Russia. But that Arch of Titus, which is over 51 feet high and was built by his brother as a legacy to him, that is there in its perfection. And you know what hurts more? If you take a look tonight, you'll see it online. If you take a look, you'll see the Arch of Titus in that wide arch. It's depicted the Jews bent over, walking out of Yerushalayim. And what are they carrying? The menorah. Why did Hashem allow that arch to exist all this time? What is so significant? Why did Hashem make it that that artist, that Goyish artist, should depict the menorah? Surely they were carrying other things as well. Now, in 1953, the Ponovitch Rav was in Rome. And he said to Dr. Rothschild, who built a hospital in Netanya, take me to the Arch of Titus. And he came there and he pointed up and he said, Titus, Titus, you thought you were going to outlast us. Today there's no Roman Empire. Do you thought that the Jews, you would get rid of them? Today, Rome is nothing. It's a city just like any other city. But the Jews, my brothers and sisters, we exist. We're learning and we're building all over. And you know what happened? About 30 or 40 years ago, there was an American correspondent who came to write about Hadrian's Wall. Hadrian was Hadrianus in the Gemara. He killed Rabbi Akiva. He was involved in killing Rabbi Akiva. And he was, they have this wall which is 73 feet long, 73 miles long, and it's in the northern part of England near the town of Newcastle by the River Tyne. And this Jewish correspondent who was not religious at all was asked to write a report about Hadrian's Wall. And he comes there and he's writing and somebody shows him the wall is not as significant as it was. It's been knocked down in many places. They build highways over it and people take down stones. So somebody said to him, you're a Jewish guy. You want to come to a Jewish neighborhood? He said, what, there's a Jewish neighborhood here? So they said, yeah, Gateshead. He said, what's Gateshead? He says, come, we'll show you. So somebody took him to Rab Leib Gurowitz, the father of Rab Avrom, who did that with the library boy. They take him to Rab Leib, and they bring him in to Rab Leib's house. Rab Leib begins to talk to him, and he sees the guy knows nothing from nothing. And he says, you came to report on Hadrian's Wall. Come here, I want to show you something. Come with me. And he takes him into the gates of Beis Medrash. Now, this American Jew, who knew nothing, had never been in a Beis Medrash, he walks in. It's like a tornado. He can't believe it. Big books, little books, off the shelves, on the shelves, yelling, screaming, back and forth. He says, Rabbi, what's going on here? Imagine a guy walks into a Beis Medrash. He never walked into a Beis Medrash in his life. Listen, and Rabbi Matas Yo Solomon told me, he remembers the day that Rabbi Lev Gurowitz brought this correspondent into the Beis Medrash and made such an impression on everyone. And listen to what Rabbi Lev tells him. He said, you came to report on Hadrian's Wall. Hadrian doesn't exist anymore. The Roman Empire doesn't exist anymore. But you see, Rabbi Akiva, that Hadrian killed all these 200 guys, they're still trying to talk and figure out what Rabbi Akiva meant. And not only that, they're dozens of places around the world, they're still talking about Rabbi Akiva, what he taught, what he meant, what he represented. Hadrian is gone. The Roman Empire is gone. And then it occurred to me, that's the reason why Hashem left the Arch of Titus. Because it's a message to all of us. That menorah is kiner mitzvah v'toyra or. We started a journey, B'tzeisim Yerushalayim. We started a journey when we left Yerushalayim. The only way that journey could come to fruition is if we hold the banner of Ner Mitzvah V'Toyra Or. As we said, mitzvahs are very important, but even more important is learning Torah and Achzakas HaTorah, supporting Torah, everybody according to their own level. That's why Hashem left that arch for us to see. That's where the journey started. That depicts the beginning of the journey, and we are continuing it, hopefully, until Mashiach. But we can only continue it if we carry that menorah that represents Ner Mitzvah V'Toyra Or. So let's review everything that we said, and we'll end with a great story. Let's remember, we've come here to connect to the past. A Jew that is not connected to the past has no hope of being prepared for the future. That's what Rav Shach told us. We can't let bygones be bygones. The Yerushalmi in Yuma tells us that if the Beis HaMikdash has not been built in our generation, it's as if, chas v'shalom, we destroyed it. Let's remember what Rav Schwab taught us. In Av, it's mematin b'simcha. We minimize our simcha, but not chas v'shalom, that there's no simcha at all. What's the simcha? Because in Tu B'Av was the greatest yantav of all, because that was a yantav for shiduchim. Because it's the same night as Pesach, the first night of the Seder. We remember at the Seder, we remember with the eggs and salt water. But we also remember on Tisha B'Av that it could be a night of chayrus. And that's why we have deep, deep happiness, because sasein v'simcha b'shuvim Yerushalayim, and that's what we hope for. Let's remember what Rav Matas Yo's Rebbe taught him. Eitz chayim hilam alzikim b'af. If you're connected to Torah, then you could flourish. But somebody who's away, it's like that leaf that's off the tree that thinks it could fly, but it's only the beginning of the end. Let's remember what the Ritvaz taught us about wind-blown Jews, about kiner, a mitzvah is very important, but it's only a ner, a wind can blow it down. The only thing that's going to maintain the strong winds is Torah, because Torah is or. Let's remember what the Ben Ish Chai told us. Av stands for Aleph Bina. It's a time when we have to increase our learning, increase our understanding. Chazal teach us that what Bar Kamsa did, he put a flaw in the lips or the eyes by us, that's a chasern. Not necessarily by the goyim of the world. Let's be careful not to say anything that's off color. Let's be careful not to cause machlokes and not to get angry. Let's remember what Rav Shalom did. Rav Shalom Shradron, he carried with him that note from the son of the Rambam, that machlokes rips asunder families, it rips asunder communities, and it rips asunder Klal Yisrael. Let's remember that's the reason why we don't wear shatnas. Because wool and linen were brought by Cain and Esav, and there was jealousy and death. And Hashem says, I don't want to be reminded of that. Let's remember we're each a walking, talking Beis HaMikdash. The head is the Arayin. The heart is the Lechem upon him. The stomach is the Mizbeach. Let's be careful. The food that we eat and the food that we give our children is from money that's kosher. Let's remember the pay and the ayin are switched in Perik Beis, Perik Gimel, Perik Dalet. Underline it tonight while you still remember, so that when you read Eicha tomorrow night, then you'll know, you'll remember forever. I have it highlighted in yellow in my Eicha, so that every year I remember how important it is to use your eye first before you use your mouth. That was the problem with the Meraglim. Let's remember that lady who thought that the principal had called her refuse. He just said refuse, and she went talking to everyone about it. That little boy in a Beis Medrash in a library who spoke with his mouth before looking into it that it was really the Rosh Hashiva. Let's remember, peh sosum, peh pasuach. Sometimes you have to keep your mouth quiet and not say, and sometimes you have to speak up. Like those people in Tayyum Cheshavos who kept their mouth quiet and another family was able to be supported. Else, Chazal teach us because there was sinas chinam. That's why the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed. We have to make a commitment, an av, that there'll be avas chinam, that we'll love each other for no other reason that we're Jews. We're all brothers and sisters, no matter what level of frumkeit anybody is, doesn't make a difference. We're all in it together. We're all here to inspire each other. And the Eibusha should help if we learn all these lessons, that we are a walking, talking human Beis HaMikdash, and we start doing chesed and we have avas chinam, we'll call out to our Father. Our Father will call out to us and He'll embrace us and bring us with Mashiach to the Beis HaMikdash. May it happen in our time. Thank you for inviting me and thank you for listening.